This is a story of the Tauber family finding our dream in America. It's late October 1956. I'm 8 months into the first year of my life. For over a decade now, the Soviets have occupied the countries all around Eastern Europe. Freedom and hope have been systematically dismantled. But the Hungarian people missed the memo. They had just staged an unexpectedly successful revolt against the brutal Soviet regime. Because the revolution happened so fast, my mother and I were caught shopping in Pest, on the eastern half of Hungary's capital, Budapest. Meanwhile, my father and my older sister awaited us in our apartment across the Danube River on the Budapest side. With gunfire whizzing overhead, my mother crossed the historic chain bridge which unites Buda and Pest, while carrying me in her arms. Recognizing the likelihood of failure, in this moment of briefest triumph, my parents made a very, very difficult decision. They chose to leave their beloved homeland behind, in the hopes of building a better future for their children and all the Tauber family to come. Now I'd like to rewind and tell the story of my parents leading up to this pivotal event in our family. My father grew up in a small border town right near Austria, in the old Austro-Hungarian Empire. He was born in 1916, the youngest of four brothers and two sisters. While not much of the details of his early life was known, we can fill in with broad strokes some things with fair accuracy. At the age of 14, while living in the far western Hungarian town of Sopron, Frank asked his father if he could buy a motorcycle that was in major disrepair. He ended up fixing the bike and using it for transportation starting in the year 1930. From then on, he began his long love affair with all the things mechanical. He was ever the tinkerer, the fixer, the handyman. These skills would take him far later on in life. His early career, however, was put on hiatus for the seven grueling years of the war. Beginning with Hungary's alignment with the Axis powers under pressure from Germany, here pictured is the leader of Hungary with Hitler in 1938. Frank was a bomber pilot for the Hungarian Air Force, fighting on behalf of the Axis powers on the Eastern Front against the Soviet Union. Over the course of World War II, he was tested in every way imaginable. He would not speak often of the war and preferred to forget the horrors that he witnessed. There was one story, though, which illustrates just how fate managed to keep the flame of the Tauber family alive. Frank and his co-pilot were on a bombing run over Soviet territory, well behind enemy lines, when their plane was shot down. He and his co-pilot parachuted safely to the ground, but they had no idea which direction they could go. Their lives, by any measure, was going to be lost. The two decided to split up. One, they both ran in opposite directions from the crash. Frank was captured, but the Hungarians pushed the front further and freed him very quickly after his temporary imprisonment. On the other hand, his co-pilot was butchered shortly after fleeing the crash. Frank survived, but exited military life a changed man, disillusioned in many ways, but more determined than ever. By 1945, he was a decorated war hero, having survived multiple plane crashes. His highest accolade during the war was that to receive the designation of Hero of Hungary. Two of his brothers weren't so lucky and presumably perished in Russian gulag sometime after the war. They were never heard from again. All this led to myself to be the sole inheritor of the Tauber name for my father's generation. After the war, Frank continued to be a very enterprising man. He saw some success as a businessman after the war, traveling around the country in diligent work. Frank was a true entrepreneur in the wine industry, and his prowess in engineering came through in designing bottling plants for the famous Hungarian liquor company, Unicum, and other bottling plants. The newly established puppet regime, controlled in reality by Moscow, did not approve of his capitalistic behavior, let alone for a man that was decorated for battling the Soviet Union. He spent some time in prison, and he had a new job, fending off party members who wanted to ruin him. His future then remained very uncertain entering the year 1956. My mother, Helen, always told me that teaching was her life's passion. Born in 1929, she lived a normal childhood for the time until the war broke out. She said the Germans were bad, but the Russians were much, much worse. She recounted to me that at age 14, when the Soviets took control of Hungary, she would have to hide underneath the bed to avoid getting raped by the soldiers going door to door. But she survived, and shortly after the war, she earned a teaching diploma. A few years before my own story begins, my father was making a wine distribution deal with Helen's uncle in Miskolc. That's my mother's hometown. When the two of them met in Miskolc, Frank saw her and said, "Hey, who's that cute girl over there?" And her uncle said, "Hey, I'll introduce you." They fell in love and they got married. Now we come back to October's end, 1956. Hungary is free, but it will not stay that way for long. In a matter of days, Soviet tanks rolled across Hungary, and with all resistance, they slaughtered and they went in there and they took over everything. There, in the process, 10,000 Hungarians were killed, 30,000 wounded, and over a quarter of a million Hungarians escaped during those crazy 3 weeks of freedom. Among them, the first family to arrive in the United States was us. My mother and I completed the crossing of the Chain Bridge and regrouped with my father and my sister. Because we had a physician family escaping with us, we decided to drape a red flag over the car, Red Cross, and we booked it for the western border. Fortunately, the border was open. Driving to Vienna, the car repeatedly broke down, and here's where my father's skill as in the car repair business came in very handy. In any case, our family reached Vienna and took a flight to the welcoming arms of Canada. We really wanted to go to the United States because my uncle had a very good friend that was an engineer at the Boeing plant, but the paperwork was just too long and too arduous. So our backup plan was to go to Canada, which welcomed us with open arms. We made headlines as the first refugee family to touch down on Canadian soil, and we got the front and the back page of the newspaper. Here's Frank, and we begin the first day of his job. He came with $1 in his pocket and no functional knowledge of the English language. He told me that he was very proud of the fact that he never accepted any government financial support of any kind. He worked hard to secure a great future for himself and for the family. He started a successful deli 2 years later in Toronto, which saw lines of people going around the block, standing in line to get his Hungarian sausage. We still make those sausages to this very day. We would remain in Toronto for 5 years while securing a passage to the United States. Awaiting in Washington was my aunt and uncle, who escaped at the same time. They became citizens in 5 years, at which time they could finally sponsor us. So the family was finally reunited in Olympia, Washington in 1962. My family had afforded me the opportunity to become whatever I wanted to as I grew up in the typical American setting. They themselves were torn, though. Although they appreciated the freedoms that America had to offer, their hearts remained back in Hungary, particularly of my mother. My mother never felt quite settled in the United States and sought to visit Hungary as much as possible. Frank worked in the U.S. Navy, among other endeavors. By the time he retired, he had become a nuclear test director in Bremerton, Washington, and occasionally around the country. This meant he could troubleshoot for nuclear power submarines and aircraft carriers. Meanwhile, Helen worked as a teacher in Olympia School District, teaching elementary school. I did not set foot in Hungary until 1972. I was 16 years old, and I was stricken by the sharp contrast between this still communist-run country and my own country. Here are the top examples that I saw as a 16-year-old. Soldiers with machine guns at all the borders, airports, and so on. We stayed in the city for more than 26 hours. For more than 24 hours, we had to check in with the local police station. And all the cities were very, very bleak. They had no advertising, no business signs. The apartments were strikingly identical, block-shaped, gray, dreary. A number of buildings were still littered with bullet holes that were left over from the revolution 16 years prior. When I arrived back in America, I was ready to kiss the ground. I did not realize until that point how wholly blessed I was. After graduating St. Martin's High School and St. Martin's College, I worked and studied in preparation for dental school. I was accepted at Tufts University in Boston, where I lived for 4 exciting years. I lived there in 1985, opening my practice, joining the Rotary, starting my ongoing teaching career at the University of Washington that same year. Here I am, right after the graduation ceremony with my mom and my dad. Also in 1985, I traveled to Hungary for the fourth time. It was a longer trip because my parents said, "You won't have very much time starting a new business, so you should have this long last summer so you could spend a little more time with us and the family." We stayed in my mother's hometown of Miskolc. Through my mother's cousin, I met Katalin Dobie. We were pen pals for 3 years until she came out to visit me in 1988. That's when the fireworks went off. By 1990, we were married, and by 1995, we were raising a family of our own, complete with a son and a daughter. Also in 1990, the collapse of the Soviet Union, a subsequent liberation of Hungary. I never imagined in my lifetime that I might see a freed Hungary and defeated Soviet Union. But through the recent actions of such leaders as Pope John Paul II, Ronald Reagan, and Mikhail Gorbachev, this horrific era of human history had been overcome. Here's a picture of my mother and father with their 4 grandkids. Frank, also an entrepreneur, took a trip to Europe right after the liberation of Hungary. He bought a nice car in Germany, drove to Budapest, visited relatives, and sold the car for a profit that paid for his trip. Unfortunately, though, although he had a long and successful life, my father was stricken with Alzheimer's in 1996. The last 4 years of his life saw him slowly slipping away down to his final resting place here in Olympia, Washington. My mother, 13 years his junior, lived to the exact same age when she passed away in 2013. They both were 84 years old. Shortly after my father's passing in 2000, I traveled to Hungary with my mother to be knighted. Although I certainly was no valiant hero for Hungary like my father was, this ceremony would be a passing on of my father's legacy, who himself was knighted and bestowed land and title upon his return from World War II. Taking part in this ceremony was one way I could show gratitude for my parents' great sacrifices that they had made possible for me to live the life that I'm living today. And here's a picture of my wife and my children on the left side at the historic Chain Bridge, where my mother crossed during the revolution of 1956. The next picture is my family and my son's graduation from the University of Washington, and as a professor from the University of Washington, I was able to be involved with the ceremony. And here is my home in Olympia, where we have been blessed with many opportunities, including beautiful rainbows and fantastic sunrises. Thank you very much.